How's it going, guys? Welcome back to another Anthem video, and if you've landed on this video, it means you're a new player and you want to know what is what, where is where, and how to do certain things, how to combo, how to build up your faction alliances and everything else. So this is the right place to be. This is going to be an over the top beginner's guide for everything you need to know. So your first objective is to get from level 1 to level 30. The easiest way to do this is to play through the campaign and to do legendary contracts once you finish the main campaign, as these will become available to you. Your legendary contracts will be your main focus of leveling outside of the main campaign, as well as your actual random missions, which will be available on the intermission screen. So main campaign, then legendary contracts, and then random missions. The random missions can land you into contracts and actual missions, and these random missions that you're going into will reward you with bonus XP because you're helping out fellow freelancers. That aside, when you're in Fort Tarsis, after every mission, make sure you speak to the NPCs inside there that are speakable. They will yield you with faction reputation. These will go towards leveling up your factions. Your factions have 3 ranks to level up currently. By speaking to everyone in Fort Tarsis every time you come back from a mission, yes, it can be a bit cumbersome, but by doing this, you do level them up a little bit faster, and your legendary contracts, 3 per day, 1 per faction, will go towards leveling those up. So you're now level 30. Next comes the all-important gear side of things, which is what you're here for. In Anthem, like many other games, gear comes in rarity. You have common, which is white, uncommon, green, rare, which is blue, epic, which is purple, masterworks, which is orange, and legendary, which is yellow, which everyone calls lemons. At least me. Right, so with common, uncommon, and rare equipment, equip what you need, because you'll burn past these very, very quickly. In fact, you'll also be burning past epic just as fast. As you level up, your main progression will be epics at a gear score of 38. They can't roll higher than 38. The next step up is 6-1 gear score, which is the masterworks, which currently are dropping at level 66. Then after that will be the gear score 75 for GM 1 and 2, and 80 for GM 3, and the seasonal war chests. So that's basically your progression. Your aim is to get everything from level 1 gear score to level 8 gear score, and get your max gear score. So as you can see, there's a lot of numbers there, so let's break that down. Epic is what you're going to be basically going towards when you're leveling up and going through the story campaign. You may pick up the odd masterwork here and there, but epic is going to be your main focus. As you're going through and masterworks start to become more and more available the higher difficulty you play, then they're going to become your next focus, and these will drop in 61 and 66 respectively, depending on the difficulty that you're playing. Once you get to GM1, that's when legendaries will start to drop, and this is when your true endgame starts to begin. Your progression will be from GM1, GM2, and GM3, and each of these have their brackets that you should be playing in based on your gear score. If you're very close to, say, GM2 and you're missing it by like 5-10 gear score, then you're probably okay to jump into GM2 because you're pretty much at the cusp of it. Right. So naturally, as you can see offhand already, the progression system isn't great. And just know that it is being worked on, but for the purpose of this video, know that your gear score generally trumps most things. Your gear score has a lot of weight behind it in terms of power, and certain things like your ultimate and melee scale directly off your max gear score. So the higher your gear score, the better. But this isn't always the case for everything, but just know that as a general rule of thumb. As a note, keep battling, don't jump into GM3 for a fast track when you're underleveled. It's not fun for you, and it won't be fun for others who are constantly picking you up or who just in the end get bored and leave you dead. Of course, if you're with your friends in a full squad, do as you like, because they are basically carrying you to get to that end game gear score a lot faster. But if you're progressing through the game on your own in a kind of single player fashion, teaming up with people through the forced matchmaking, then be courteous to your other players and stay within the brackets that you're supposed to be in. Right, so that's the whole leveling aspect out the way. Combos. How does one combo? Anthem incorporates a priming system and a detonation system. Primers prepare the target while detonators detonate the combo and finish the cycle. Primers are always elemental. You can freeze, poison, or burn targets. Applying an ice elemental effect on a target freezes them in place, and this is a great crowd control ability if you're getting overrun or simply if you want to prime many targets at once. Poison reduces the enemy's defense, allowing all allies to deal more damage, while priming the target and allowing for bigger damage combos due to the defense of the enemy being reduced. Fire, finally, allows you to set the target on fire, as it says, and this has a damage over time tick, which is very rapid and does constant damage to the enemy, and if you're actually specking for fire, this tick can be quite deadly, upwards of 75,000 per tick once your build is adequately set. While in this state, the enemies are primed and ready to combo. So, what abilities can combo? There are a select few weapons that can detonate, but I wouldn't rely on these. They're more of a gimmick. Maybe the Truth of Tarsus can be utilized here, but I would steer away from weapons as detonators for the most part. Your melee and abilities will be your main detonator. You'll see this symbol you're seeing on screen now next to your items and abilities. That symbol is signifying that this ability or this attack is a detonator, and as such, if it hits a prime target, it will detonate, creating a combo. So once a target is primed and you simply fire your detonator, you create what is a combo, and that deals more damage than a standard hit. A lot more damage, in fact. And as such, you should always be aiming for priming and comboing. There are select abilities that will not prime or combo, and these ones actually have a higher base damage to compensate for that if you do not want to go down the road of priming and detonating for combos. However, overall, you want to learn this mechanic because it will be your bread and butter, and it will remove massive chunks of health later on, as opposed to the ones that don't have any effect on them, which basically, as of right now, just don't really get used at all. So that is the basics for comboing. You cannot combo without priming a target. You can, however, combo off someone else's primed target. So don't hold back if you're seeing allies priming. It's all free game to detonate that sweet, sweet combo. So, I repeat, prime a target with an elemental, detonate with a detonator. You can have two items equipped on your javelin. You can have one primer and one combo, so you can prime your own target and detonate your own target. It's all up to you or your team how your composition wants to do it. You can roll with double detonators and have a storm that's constantly priming targets, so you can increase the number of times that you can actually detonate within your cooldown period. So overall, this is something that you can play around with, but if you're starting out, make sure to have a primer and a detonator and go to town. So that's combos explained and out the way. Now we come to the final aspect of gearing. Inscriptions. These are the perks under the ability that you will see, which are randomly chosen, also known as random rolls in other games. Your abilities, components, and weapons will all have these, and these will be the difference between them being amazing and being complete turd. For example, you could have a Gerard's Wrath with no weapon damage and 2 stats of armor. This would be great if you're specking for armor, but if you're looking for that damage output, it's just not going to add anything to it. This weapon will be restricted to the base damage it does. However, you can also have 2 max weapon rolls of 250% and 175%, giving you a grand total of 425% extra damage on top of the 100 base you're getting. As you can imagine, the difference in damage will be very big. So your inscriptions make the world of difference. An example of this would be ultimate damage, for example, which is another inscription. If you have no ultimate damage as a Colossus, let's say your ultimate will do maybe around 600 to 800,000 damage per shot. You get 3 shots, 800,000 if you're lucky. But specking for ultimate damage in all slots, you can hit around 6 million a shot on Colossus from the 600k. You get 3 shots, that's pretty amazing damage, right? You're going from 600k to a maximum of around 6 million. That's a huge increase. So you live and die by your inscriptions. Make sure you build your builds based around your inscriptions, because the game is flexible to the point where you can play the style you want based around these inscriptions. Of course, getting these inscriptions is no easy feat. You can spend weeks farming for that elusive roll that you need, but when it lands, oh, does it feel sweet. Next, we have your components. This is where your build diversity comes in. You want to be a super tank, a mix between the lot, a glass cannon, purely built on ultimate damage, priming build, comboing build, detonating build. You see where I'm going with this. The way you play the game and the build you go with is truly at your disposal, and you can go with whichever direction you want. Your only barrier of restriction is actually getting the inscriptions that you actually need. Next we have your components, and these are your bread and butter. These are the ones that will help you define your build. You have javelin specific components, and then you have universal components. Javelin specific components are built specifically for your javelin and utilize your specific javelin's abilities, but they cannot roll a damage inscription. So one of them might have, for example, your shield bash does 300% more damage. Great. But it can't roll an additional damage roll underneath because these are specific to your javelin and you're already getting damage perks on the actual component itself. However, universal components, which can be used by any javelin, despite having a lower armor and shield ratio, can roll damage perks. So the majority of people generally go for a few components from the actual pool of their specific rollout, and then go with universal rolls for the extra damage, extra armor, extra ultimate damage, and so forth. Because the universal components are the only ones that can roll damage rolls. For example, an emergency power component designed for ultimate damage can also be rolled with two ultimate damages, making it the ideal god roll that is sought after by almost everyone. You get 30%, if I'm not mistaken, from the actual component itself. Then you can roll 50% in slot 1 for additional damage, knocking it up to 80%. And I believe in slot 2 you can roll another 50%, or is it restricted to 40? Don't quote me on that, but it is quite high. I've seen it around 38% already, as you can see on screen. So between the three of those, you can get up to 130% ultimate damage just off one inscription. That's amazing. That will add insane amounts of damage to your ultimate. So it's all down to the player to decide what is right for their playstyle. Do you want to go with an ultimate build? Do you not want to go with an ultimate build? For Interceptor, for example, it's not really recommended to go with an ultimate build because the majority of the time you're using your melee to attack. So with the Interceptor, you would want to go with something that's more melee orientated, and therefore you want to go with melee damage or weapon damage that's universal, which also counts towards your melee. So stuff like this is what you need to consider going forward, building towards the javelin's strengths, not just one fits all. Crafting. Crafting in Anthem is not in a great state at present, and I would not invest much time in this aspect of the game. Honestly, till it's overhauled and made useful, I would ignore it almost entirely, but essentially it uses the embers you collect and the blueprints you unlock through your factions, the Arcanist, Sentinel, Freelancers, in order to craft components and weapons and stuff like this. But seeing as you can't craft legendaries, there's really very little value to this once you hit level 30 and you've already got the Masterworks, because Masterworks, in all fairness, rain like candy. So until they overhaul this and fix this, just ignore it. Lastly, we have Sigils. At level 30, you can equip 3 of these. These add very big bonuses to your javelin. They are single use and use the embers you have collected. The Epic Sigils give you 30% additional bonus based on the sigil you're having. So this could be 30% combo damage, ultimate damage, fire damage, increase to armor, shields. Sadly, however, you can't use more than one of the same kind. So let's say you wanted to go with an ultimate build and you've got an ultimate sigil which gives you 30%. You can't use another 2 Epic Ultimate Sigils. You would have to use a rare ultimate sigil which gives you 20%, and then an uncommon which gives you 10%. At which point the 10% probably isn't worth it unless it's actually going to complete that 5 tick. Now I'll get to that 5 tick in a bit, but just know that if you want to fill up all 3 sigils with the same type, it needs to be different rarities. Epics roll at 30%. Rare at 20%, as you've probably gathered, and uncommon at 10%. So, this tick, what is it that I'm talking about? So let's say, for example, you have 396 ultimate damage, and then you have 399 ultimate damage. You would expect that the 399 would do more damage than the 396, even if it's marginal, but that is incorrect because it goes up in fives. Therefore, both of them are actually hitting at 395, and this is where that 10 extra comes in. If you're so close, or if you want to push past the next barrier, then you can do this. Or if you're already at a multiplier of 5, say 395, then by using 10, you actually get a good bonus for this, because it increases it another 2 tiers, because you go to 400 and then 405. So it's something to keep in mind when you're using sigils, and make sure that you are actually increasing correctly. Right, that is your sigils out the way. Just remember, you can't use 3 of the same rarity of the same kind at the same time. It needs to be different rarities. Dailies and weeklies, alliances and clans. Yes, you have a set of dailies every day. These will reward you with materials, but more importantly, many will give you coin, which is the in-game currency used to buy items from the store. Yes, you can also buy shards for real money and purchase items from the store if you wish, but you will get an average of about 10 to 11,000 a week from just doing your dailies, which is pretty fair if you ask me. You also have a set of weeklies to do, and these will yield you up to 10,000 coin a week if you do all of them. And they are not difficult, they're not that time consuming. If you're playing the game, for the most part you'll get these done as you're playing anyway. Your alliance is something you have no control over. Every week you'll be assigned 5 active people from your friends list, and as they play the game and rank up their alliance rank, this in turn provides you with a percentage and increase to your weekly coin gain. In the bottom left, you will see how much you will gain based on your own activity. The maximum rank is 10, and if you complete rank 10 to max, as if you were going to 11, you can get up to 13k from this, providing everyone in your friends list has actually completed that max rank 10. This of course totals to a rough maximum of 30 to 35,000 coin a week, and if you're doing everything weekly, then you should be okay getting an armor set from the store once every 2 weeks, which is fair if you ask me, as that's the only way the game is being monetized. However, now, if you join an active clan, like mine for example, this will help you in regards, as in to give you a greater pool to find active players instead of limiting you to your friends list. Currently, the alliance system will only look at your friends because you're not part of a clan, but if you join an active clan, when your alliance looks at active players, it will look into that list of active players within the clan and pull the 5 that are active from the previous week, and this will enable you to gain that bit much more coin that bit more easier. If you're interested in joining my clan is in the description below. If you're interested in joining my clan, you can do so. The PS4 has limited space available, but the Xbox and PC is still rapidly recruiting and there are more people joining daily, so feel free to apply, and if you do apply, I will accept the next time I boot the application up. The way you apply for a clan is simple. You download the app onto your iOS or Android device, search for the clan, the name is Chaos Dead Legion, which is again in the description below, and make that application. Just know that we use Discord to communicate, not the app itself, because the app is pretty bad when it comes to that. So if you are going to join, please head over to Discord and introduce yourself and have fun with everyone, because that is where all the grouping takes place. And that, freelancers, is the basic coverage of Anthem. This was an overview of all aspects. It gives you a nice stepping stone of what you need to know, and hopefully this has answered many questions that you had. If there are any more questions that you wish to know about, any more you wish to ask, leave them in the comment section below and I will get back to you. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope it was useful to you, and until the next video, which will be on my top wants for Anthem 2.0, and boy are they amazing. I'm gonna go all out with that list. So I hope you all are watching, and I hope everyone out there is watching. So until then, remain legend. Thanks so much for watching my video. If you look over to the left, you'll find a video that I'm recommending to you that I think you might actually enjoy. On the right, you'll see a video that is recommended by YouTube. I really do hope you enjoyed the video, and until the next one, remember to always remain legend.